me than they are you. I just want to note that right now. All right, well, I want to welcome you all this morning to our church service. It's Grad Sunday, and we are super excited. We have our youth band up here along with some of the ones from Sunday morning. I just want to ask you all to stand up. I'm going to pray over us real quick and get started, and just pray that you'll sing along with us. Father, I just want to come before you today, and I just thank you for a day of celebration, God, as we celebrate what you've done in and through these students today, God. And I just pray that you would just be with us today as we sing your praises, God, as we dive into your word. And Lord, I just pray especially over these graduates, God, that you would just use them in a mighty way, God. I pray over them as they go into their next chapter, God, that they will go in with full force and in all that you have for them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Come, so fight for me.
Hey,
sing a little louder.
You may be seated. So glad that you're here this morning. First of all, glad that you came to worship with us this morning. Glad that you came to celebrate who Jesus is and what Jesus has done for us this morning by worshiping, praising Him, listening to the message that He has for us. So thank you for being with us. If you're a guest with us, we've got a welcome center out back. And, if you'll stop by that after the service, stop by the welcome center, we'll get you to fill out a connection card and you can get a free gift. Free gifts are always fun. So anyway, if you'll stop back by there after the service, we'd appreciate it. So let's get to the part where most of you guessed or the reason you're here. Today is Grad Sunday, as Tiffany said earlier, where we recognize our graduates. And so these are the graduates that are a part of our church in some way or another. And so we're going to recognize them. They're going to be getting a Bible doing that, and we'll be feeding them lunch afterwards. So we're going to be recognizing our high school graduates first, and then Anna's going to come up here and recognize our college graduates as well. So, first of all, first graduate we have is Trent Atkins. His plans are he is going to be going to JSU, and he doesn't have job plans yet. That is okay. This is Trent. Okay? Next we have Bailey Blackwell. Her plans are to attend the University of Alabama, and her plans are to get a job in the medical field. Next, we have Carson Brown. He plans on, first of all, going to Gadsden State and then transferring to JSU, where he wants to get a degree in computer science and programming, and he wants to become a game developer. Next is Daylon Day. He's going to Gadsden State, and his career plans are job hunting. Next is Trent Dooley. Trent's planning on going to Gadsden State, and at this point, he doesn't know what he wants to do either. Okay.
Next is Hunter Farley. Hunter right now is lined up to do an electrician's apprenticeship, and he wants to be an electrician. That's good that he's doing an electrician apprenticeship. Next we have Drake Rainey. Drake is planning on attending JSU, and his job plans are unknown. Next, we have Maddie Smith, who also is attending Jacksonville State University, and she wants to be an occupational therapist. Next, we have Allie Tanner, who is going to be roommates with Bailey at the University of Alabama, and she wants to be a surgeon. Yeah. And finally, we have Cole Turner, who... And again, he started the trend of saying unknown for his job plans. So those are our high school graduates. And now I'm going to ask Anna to come up and recognize our college graduates.
Okay, I'm going to start with Emily Day since she's here.
Pray for these graduates. Dear God, here we are coming before you, lifting up not only these graduates, not only these college graduates, God, but all the graduates that are graduating this spring. And we just want to say thank you for the ability that you've given to get this far. God, we just ask that they use these abilities to bring you forward, use this education to bring look at them and go, God is doing something in their life. God, I just ask that you help us to encourage them, help us to spur them on, bring you praise, honor, and glory. Thank you for the parents, the grandparents, the family, other family and friends that have supported them. Thank you for putting them as a part of our lives. In Jesus' name I pray.
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. I can count the times I've called your name some broken night. Thank you. sun goes down. Love him in the morning, love him in the noontime. Love him when the sun goes down.
obviously at this time, our children can be dismissed to children's church. So, obviously at this time of year, a lot of people get nostalgic. A lot of people go back and think about, you know, the way things were in middle school or their freshman year or elementary school or kindergarten. Well, I want you to go back to those times. You can think about it for a minute and go back to, we'll just go back to kindergarten. A pre-K, either one of those. And I want you to think about something for a minute. I want you to think about arts and crafts. I want you to think about arts and craft time in elementary school, or early elementary school, kindergarten, or pre-K. I want you to think about how good you thought you were. Think about how awesome you thought that Christmas ornament was. I've seen some of my Christmas ornaments from then. Think about we used to do, when I was in early elementary school, we used to do this thing called tin punch, where you take like a thin sheet of copper and overlay a stencil on it, and then you take a hammer and nail and go there. Somewhere around here, I've got some duck that I did that, man, it just looked like I went like that. Again, not very good. But probably the worst arts and crafts that you can do with kindergartners, early elementary, is pottery. Think about that. Think about maybe you, or think about your kids, or maybe your grandkids came and they have made something. Even now, you look back and go, what is that? Is that a bowl? Is that a trivet? Is that a coaster? Is it a blob? You think about it. But again, think about how good you thought that was. You're like, oh, here it is. And your mom. And thank you for moms. That is so wonderful. It looks so good. And it gets put on the mantle at least for a little while. Though we know that that was not good part. We know that that was not a good Christmas one. We know that that was not a good piece of art. But the thing about it is we thought it was great, even though it wasn't. And we look around and we go, you know what? There are some really, really good artists out there. Right, there are. You know, we look out there and we go, that person can sculpt, or that person can put together a car in such a way that is just amazing, or this person can carve wood, or this person is a good carpenter, or whatever it is, you know, and art's all kinds of stuff now. But we look at it and go, that person's good, that person's not. I would probably fall into that category of not. But so this morning, as we're talking about this, digging into the sermon, I want to not talk about us as the potter, or us as the carpenter, or us as the painter, but I want to look at the potter. I want to look at the carpenter. I want to look at the creator. And if he, when I say that, I mean capital T, capital H, capital E, the creator, God. Obviously, hopefully that's obvious. If he is that, if he is the premier example of those things, well, what does that make us? Well, let's take a look. If you turn your Bibles to Isaiah 64, verse 8, it's going to read like this. It goes, "But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the works of your hand." So, if he is the potter, the carpenter, the artist, what does that make us? That makes us the potter. That makes us the painter. That makes us the sculpture. That makes us the And so we're going to dig in this morning and say, why does that matter? Why does that matter in my life? Why does this matter? Why would we talk about this at graduation? Why does this matter as a part of my life, as part of my daily routine? Why does it matter that God's the creator and I'm the creation? God's the potter and that I'm the clay? So that's what we're going to dig into this morning. First of all, let's pray. Dear God, I come before you right now just asking that you open up our hearts, that you soften our hearts and receive the word that you have for us this morning. God, so that we can turn around and apply it to our life and praise you with our obedience. Help us to realize what it means that you are potter and creator. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So, the first thing we need to look at, the first thing that we have to understand is this, that the Father created. For a lot of people, that's a duh statement, but I want to make sure that we're backing that up. If you turn, you don't have to turn there, but Psalms 139, 114, pretty familiar verse. It says, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. That is the psalmist acknowledging that God created him and created him for a purpose and made him specific, made him wonderful. Made us exactly how he planned. We are created perfectly. Let that sink in for just a second. We are created perfectly. How can we know that we're created perfectly? Because God is perfect and he is our creator. And he doesn't mess up. So what he planned, how he planned it, is how we were created. There's no flaw. There's no flaw in who we are. We couldn't be any better. There's no way that we can compare ourselves to anything else. We are better than a Da Vinci painting. We are better than a Michelangelo sculpture. We are better than a Michael Jordan dunk. We are better than an Andrew Lloyd Wright building. We are better than a Stradivarius violin. We are better than any of those masterpieces that have ever been created, because God created us. He made us, and he just didn't make us out of stuff. He made the stuff. He didn't take bone and muscle and vessels and brain tissue and teeth and skin and put us together. He said, out of nothing, here's bone. Out of nothing, here's skin. Out of nothing, here's muscle. Out of nothing, here's teeth. Here's hair. Here's eyes. Perfectly put us together. Without flaw, without blemish, he put us together, and we are exactly how he has planned. And how do we know that? Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It's out of nothing. He didn't say he took this and took that. He just made it. He spoke, and it happened. That's what he, not only did he do that for the world, the universe, the moon, the stars, the seas, the mountains, he did that for us. He knew what his goal was from the very beginning. And the thing about it is we can sit and we can sit in our bedroom, and we can look in the mirror, and we can start to complain. We can say, God, I think you messed up. Why am I not taller? Why did you give me this color hair? Why did you not give me those talents? Why am I not that smart? And we can sit and we can question God's design. The problem is just that. He made us exactly how he wanted us to be. And in order for us to question that, we're questioning him. We're questioning who he is. We are questioning what he made. Think about that for a minute. If you've ever made something and you know you were proud of it, and you know that you made it for just how you needed it to be, and somebody starts questioning you about it, you're like, well, hold up. I planned on this. I made it for this purpose. I made it to do this. And there's reasons behind everything that I just did. I didn't see you cutting the wood. I didn't see you putting the screws in. If we're like that on our level, just think about where God is. God's like, okay, so you're questioning me. I'm just saying, like he said, Job, where were you? First of all, we have to understand that the Father created us, perfectly created us, intricately designed us. But the thing about it is, as the title of my sermon says, we are more than a piece of art made to just sit and look at. Look pretty in a chair or look pretty up on a wall. That would be weird for us to hang on a wall. But anyway, we're more than just a piece of art. Okay? He created you with a purpose. He created each one of us for a purpose. Jeremiah 29:11. I'll be honest, I almost didn't put this verse in here because I was like, are going to use this verse at this time of year. But it fits. It's perfect. It says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for your welfare, not for evil. To give you a future and a hope." Okay, first and foremost, when he talks about he has plans for us, when he created us for a purpose, first and foremost, we are created to praise him. To praise him with our voice, to praise him with our devotion, to praise us with our praise him with our actions, to praise him with our decisions. That's first and foremost. But that is a general purpose for all people. A general purpose for each one of us so that we can praise him. So that's bottom line what we're supposed to do. But the thing about it is not only did he create us as a whole to praise him, he has a specific purpose for each one of us. He's like, maybe not me. Yeah, you. He has a specific purpose for each individual. And the thing about it is we use terminology in the church that specific purpose for each individual, here's the phrase that we always use. What is God's will for my life? That's a specific purpose for you. What is God's will for your life? I'm not going to sit here this morning and just be like, well, God's will for your life is this, or God's will for your life is this. And we want to know that, right? We want to know what is God's will for my life. We want to know his plans for our job, for our family, where we're going to live, what we're going to do, et cetera, et cetera. God, just show me what you want me to do. And we work with that, and we struggle with that. And why sometimes is it so hard for us to figure that out? Because we get distracted. We get distracted by the world around us. We get distracted by this attractive thing over here or this storm over here. And we get distracted so we can't figure out what God's will is because we're looking someplace else. Maybe you've got sin in your life that's creating a barrier between you and God, so he can't speak to you because sins just mess you up so much that you haven't taken care of it, then people and God can't speak and we can't hear him because of the sin that we have in our life. Or finally, it may be just we don't want it to be that. Sometimes we struggle with knowing God's will for our life. It's not because we don't know what God's will for our life is. It's because we just don't want it to be that. I had a good friend of mine. His name's David Zimmerman. And he had been married a couple of years, and God was calling him into the ministry. And his wife, Leanne, fought and struggled with David being called into the ministry. Because in Leanne's mind, this was what was going to happen. David was going to get called into ministry. As soon as he got called into ministry and got settled in somewhere, God was going to call him to the mission field. Not only was God going to call him to the mission field, God was going to call him to Africa. Okay? And when they moved to Africa, she was going to get pregnant, and she was going to have her babies on banana leaves. Direct quote. She didn't want David to go into ministry. And she jokingly says, I didn't want David to go into ministry because I didn't want to have my babies on banana leaves. She didn't want to hear it. Eventually she, you know, said, how dumb am I? How selfish am I? She heard it, but she didn't want to admit what God was calling her to do. So we have struggles sometimes knowing what God's plan is because sometimes we're not honed in on it. Sometimes it's hard when we are honed in on what God's specific plan for our life is, but we've got to make sure we've taken care of everything else so that we can do it. And even though it is hard, we have to understand that God's plan for us, as Jeremiah 29:11 said, is for us to prosper and to have a future. Even though it's hard for us to understand, sometimes it's hard for us to follow God's will. He wants us to have a future. That prosperity and that future may not look like what the world seems as grand, but there's no better place to be. President of Seminary, Dr. Hemphill, our first chapel when we got to seminary. He goes, guys, I want to tell you something. I'm translating it from Randy because I don't remember exactly how he said it, but you'll get the gist of it. Guys, I want to tell you something. The two most miserable people in the world are those people that are called to ministry and not in ministry. And those people that aren't called to ministry and are in ministry. He goes, if you're not called, don't be here. We have to be in the will of God. Because it is only through the will of God that we can find fulfillment. That we can find what he wants. And the thing about it is guess what? This is not fate. This is not destiny. We have a choice in this. God wants us to choose him. God wants us to choose his will. So that he can be praised. So that he can be glorified in our choice. So which leads us to the last point. He's created us. He's created us for a purpose. But the last thing that we have to understand is this, is that his purpose is the best purpose. His will for your life is the best thing that you can do. Okay. I'm going to read this passage. I'm going to read this verse twice. One out of the ESV, which we normally do, and then I'm going to read it out of a different translation in just a second. And you'll see why. Okay, so Isaiah 29:16, reads like this. He goes, you turn things upside down. Shall the potter be regarded as the clay that the thing made should say of its maker, he did not make me? Or the thing formed say of him who formed it, he has no understanding? Okay, that's ESV. That's started to read in and dig in. I was like, I like that, because this is saying that we think that we know better for God's plan than what God does. So as I was leading, I read through a different translation. Then I came to one that really just spoke to me. Translation, it's the New Living Translation. Y'all just listen. I love this translation of this verse. It goes, how foolish can you be? He is the potter, and he certainly greater than you, the clay. Should the created thing say to the one who made it, he didn't make me? Now listen, does a jar ever say, the potter who made me is stupid? That's real right there. That gets down to us understanding what Isaiah is trying to say right there. He's saying, hey, when you're telling God that your plans are better than his plan, I'm telling you, you're stupid. Okay, well, let me explain. At this time of year, graduates and people that go to graduations, even kindergarten graduation, elementary school graduation, middle school graduation, college graduation, all this kind of stuff, you're going to hear several things. You can do it. Be who you want to be. You can do anything you set your mind to. Oh, the places you'll go. The world is your oyster. I have no idea what that means. People say. And you hear those things. And the thing about it is this. Those things are true. You can be anything you want to be. You can go anywhere you want to do. You can do anything you set your mind to. The thing about it is, those are your plans, not this plan. You can choose to go your own way. You can choose to follow him. It is only when we follow his plan that we can find true contentment, true fulfillment, and true joy by being in the center of his will. Yes, God is going to allow you to do your own thing if you choose to do that. Never going to be truly fulfilled in doing what you want to do instead of what God wants you to do. Because when we do our own thing, we are breaking fellowship with him. We are living in sin, and God can't fellowship with sin. And we can only find joy, contentment, and fulfillment in fellowship with him. You go decide to do your own thing as far as a career, that's not going to happen because you're outside of his will. If you go and decide to marry whoever you want to marry or be in a relationship with whoever you want to be with, you'll never find those things. If you decide to go your own way, you will never find those things because it only comes through fellowship with him. Even if we don't agree with his plans, who are we to say anything? Remember what we talked about? That his plans were perfect? Who are we, the creator, creation, to say anything about the creator? Who are we to say, are you stupid? The thing about it is his plans may not look glamorous to the world around us. They may not look exciting. They may not look prosperous to the world around us. But verse for you from Romans 9:21. It says, "Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another one for dishonorable use?" Isn't it the potter's, the creator's prerogative to make the vessels the way that he sees fit and what he needs them for? Let me give you an example. Here I have two knives. This knife here is one that I got on a family vacation when I was elementary school. It's got an antler handle. It's got some brass here. It's got some scrimshaw stuff here on the blade. And it's got a nice stamped sheath here. It's really, really nice knife. If anybody's interested, it's a Kissing Crane. And like I said, it's a really beautiful knife. It's a fancy knife. It's a knife, one of those knives that you put in a shadow box and hang on your wall or put on your desk or you just have it and you look at it. It can still do the things that the knife does. But do you really want to do that with this knife? No, not really. It just looks too nice. On the other hand, I have this knife here. This knife here is the blade's sharp, but you can tell it's been worn down and sharpened many, many times. The handle is a looped leather handle here. And you can tell it's been worn. The sheath is all got nicks in it. The pommel here has got some nicks in it. This knife was my dad's knife that he would carry when he would go camping, when he needed a knife, like a sheath knife like this. It's beautiful because of that, but if you just compare the knives, there's not a lot of comparison as far as the beauty of these knives. But let me tell you what, if you need a knife to do something, this is the knife you want. This is the sharp knife. This is the one that, hey, this is the one that's going to do stuff. This is the stuff that's going to make kindling. This is the stuff that's going to make shavings. This is the ones that's going to cut string. This is the one that's going to do the things that you need it to do. Even though it doesn't look pretty, and even though it's not going to win any awards for grandest design, when you need a knife, this is the one you want. Here's the thing. We look at our lives like this, right? And we say, well, God, why did you not make me like this one? Why didn't you give me, you know, fanciness? Why do I have to be like this? Which one is more helpful? Which one is more necessary? And I promise you, when you need a knife, nothing's better than a knife that's made for that purpose. So God has a plan, and even though you may feel like I'm this knife instead of this knife, think about that a moment. How is God using you? How is God going to use you? Can he use you because you are this instead of making you in such a way that you don't feel like you can get dirty or get messed up, so you just want to sit on the shelf? God has a specific plan for your life, and that plan is the best plan. The last thing we're going to look at this point is this. Yes, God has a specific plan for you. He has a specific will for your life. Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we stray from that path. Sometimes we get selfish and want to do our own thing. It's not a one and done thing. Okay? It's not like you're driving on a bridge and you make a wrong choice and you drive off the bridge and dive into the water and you can't get back on the bridge. When you make a wrong decision, when you get out of sight of God's will for your life, guess what? Yes, there are consequences. But it's not a one and done. God will call you back. God will welcome you back. He may not be able to use you in the same way that he was going to use you before, but he is still going to use you. He is still going to use you to bring him glory. And you can still find contentment. You can still find fulfillment. You can still find joy in his will. You can't expect God to bless you when you're outside of that. When you've made a wrong choice, when you've made a wrong decision, but when you confess that sin and you recognize what you have done, how you've broken fellowship, and ask for forgiveness and come back into his will, he will still use you. He will still come alongside you. Still. Where are you right now? What are your plans right now? And I'm not just talking to seniors. I'm not talking to graduates right now. I'm talking to every person in this room. Are you sitting in God's will? Are you doing the things that he's called you to do? Are you going, no, that's too hard. That's not glamorous enough. That's not exciting enough. I want to do my own. Do you have fellowship with him? Or are you out of fellowship with him? Are you really finding joy and contentment and fulfillment? Are you just trying to fake it until you make it? You're never going to make it outside of fellowship with him. Again, if you're outside of that, what are your plans? Where are your plans going to take you? Are they going to take you down your path? Or are they going to take you down God's path? I'm fixing to pray. And then we're going to have a time of response. And this is what I'd like. I would like for, when we start the time of response, I'd like for all of our graduates, I know what I'm asking, all of our graduates to come down and kneel here at our altar. We got a long altar, so there's plenty of room. And after, when the graduates come down here and kneel at the altar, what I'd like is I'd like for family, friends, teachers, and Sunday school teachers, small group leaders to come and pray. Just gather around. Hey, we have to fill this whole front section up, and so be it. But I want to spend time praying for our graduates, praying that they will continue and choose to stay in God's will. And if you need to come down and say, God, help me stay in your will, you come down and pray too. But a time of response is going to be that. If you need to make a decision to follow God and to join our church and to know what it means to have fellowship with God, we'll have counselors over here on the side that you can come talk to. Because the thing about it is all of this doesn't matter if you don't have a relationship with Jesus. You'll always be outside of his will without having a relationship with him. You'll never find those things of contentment and joy and peace and fulfillment outside of having a relationship with him. Don't know what that means. If you want to know what that means, our counselors will be over here and you can come talk to them. Brother Ron will be down here if you need to talk to him. But I want you to come and I want us to spend time in prayer saying, God, show me your will. Help me stay. Let's pray. Dear God, I come before you right now. accepting these graduates. First of all, lifting every single person up in this room. Lifting every single person in this room up to you. Asking them. You help us to cling to you. Help us to cling to your purpose so that you can be glorified. In all of you. Graduates come forward and your family come pray with them.
A healing light just beyond the clouds. Though I've walked through fire, I see clearly now. I know nothing has been wasted, no failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter. I'm the canvas and the clay. You make all and for my
Brother Randy, for the message, and congratulations, graduates. You've been waiting for this time for a long time, and you've made it. And papers are flying, but that's okay. It's so good to have you today. Again, if you're a guest, welcome. So glad that you're here. If you're a first-time guest, please stop by the welcome desk that's out there, and you can fill out a connection card. We'll be glad to give you a free gift for doing that. I also want to make sure everybody's aware that we have a special called business meeting tonight at 4 o'clock, so before OCD. I don't anticipate it being a long meeting, but we need people here for the meeting or no business can take place. So please, if you will, come at 4 o'clock. We need you there for that business meeting. Also, please note that on your worship guide, we have a couple of QR codes on the back. If you want to give, you can just scan that with the camera on your smartphone. Or if you're a visitor, you can scan that and fill out the connection card from there. So there's just something new that we have for you. We also have a new member for our church, and I'd like to introduce you to Matthew McDonald. Matthew, if you'll kind of stand and just wave at everybody just real quickly. There he is. We are glad to have Matthew. Matthew has recently prayed to receive Jesus as his personal Lord and Savior, and he's going to follow the Lord in believers' baptism in the coming weeks. Praise God. And so he will be joining the church by baptism. If you rejoice in that, would you signify by saying amen? Amen. Praise God. So excited for him. Is there another word of announcement that needs to be shared at this time?
You and your immediate family will go downstairs after the service. That's what we have in lunch. So the service is over. You and your immediate family will make your way downstairs. We'll have lunch ready for you.
Wonderful. Sounds good. Miss Heather? Very good. Thank you. Again, the children are going on a boat ride next week, leaving 9:45. They'll be back after the service. So more information, contact Heather or one of the children's leaders. Is there another announcement that needs to be shared? Such a great Sunday, and so excited to see each of you. We have a sing-out song today, do we not?
Yes.
We do.
Yes.
And so it's always good. So let's stand and let's sing out to the Lord Jesus. God bless you. Have a great afternoon.
Good God Almighty, I hope you find me. Praise your name no matter what comes, 'cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. So is he good?
He's good.
The sun goes down,
Jesus in the morning,
Jesus in the noon.